All right, well, let's go ahead and get started. So welcome everybody to the training tonight. My name is Nathan McCullough and I am a gold director from America. And tonight we are going to be talking about the three elements of success, and in particular, the three characteristics that it takes to really be successful as an entrepreneur and as someone who really wants to build a business that requires teams and teamwork. So that's going to be the main focus for the presentation tonight. So it's good to see some new faces on the call tonight. So if you are new, then this is perfect, right? This will play right into the game plan session that you're going to have with your coach coming up soon. And it's really one of the key elements of what we teach our new associates. In our STI team, we have four key values and we have four key characteristics. So the values are integrity, excellence, loyalty, and humility. So these are the kind of four values that we have that go through our entire organization. And then the characteristics that we have, we're going to be talking about three of them tonight. So being willing, coachable, and hungry. And then the fourth one is being a team player. And these eight elements really make up the key components for how to be successful in the business, but also how to be successful and effective as a communicator, as a human being, as a person, as a brother, a sister, a leader in your community. All of these things are really key elements of what it takes to be an effective human being. And so tonight we're gonna talk about the three key elements of success when it comes to particular characteristics. Okay, so when you join a business or when you become an entrepreneur, it is not like having a boss. Okay, so if some of you are new to the business, you've never been an entrepreneur before, you've never been in business before, then you've probably had a job, you probably worked for a boss. And when you have a boss, generally, you know, they give you a script to follow, or they give you work to do each day, they give you assignments, and then you get paid basically for showing up. And that's kind of what it's like to be an employee, have a boss, that type of thing. You're kind of waiting for instructions, essentially. As an entrepreneur, you have to tell yourself what to do, right? You have to create your own structure and you have to be prepared to do whatever it takes in order to create the results that keep your business afloat, right? One of the things about being an entrepreneur is that everything starts and ends with you. Your success and your failure is up to you. As an employee, if the business fails, it's like, yeah, you're out of a job, but it's not a huge deal. As an entrepreneur, you know, everything really falls on you. And so it's not just about being effective at growing your business. It's about creating a foundation and that you can build with yourself, so that the business actually rests on you, right? You're really the foundation of that. So to be an entrepreneur and to be successful an entrepreneur, you have to be able to take the right actions consistently to produce the results that are required for success, right? No one can be successful for you. So all the training, all the coaching, all the support from your company and from the coach and from your team is not going to make any difference if you don't use it, right? If you don't take the action. And ultimately, only we can decide how successful that we're going to be. Okay. And so, as we mentioned before, the being successful requires three vital attributes or characteristics. Okay. You have to be willing, you have to be coachable, and you have to be hungry. And what we're going to do is we're going to actually walk through and look at what that means. Okay. So in the USANA journey, let me just change my, so you guys can see. So in your USANA journey, your coach's job is really to guide you along the way. It's to help share their experience, right? What are the things that have worked for them? What are the things that didn't work from them? And share with you about how they got through the challenges and the obstacles and the things that they've dealt with along the way so that you don't have to make the same mistakes, right? And also provide you with accountability, okay? So if, you know, David, you're a personal trainer, okay? One of the key roles of a personal trainer is not just showing people what to do, but it's actually being that accountability structure for people. Okay. People very rarely show up to the gym on their own. They might go for a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks, but ultimately if they're not showing up for someone else, a lot of times, then they just stop going because they haven't built that habit yet. And they don't have that discipline yet. And so as a coach, you're accountability is a big part of that. Okay. So you want to really lean on your coach for the accountability and allow them to hold you accountable along the way, because they're going to help you do things that you wouldn't do without them, that you wouldn't ordinarily do, right? Working out is perfect, right? I love working out, go to the gym, right? But there is no doubt about the fact that when you're working with a personal trainer or a coach, you will do an extra couple of reps. You'll do another set that if that person wasn't there, you wouldn't do. They'll push you and do a little bit more, right? And it's in that little bit more, it's in that extra set, it's in that extra couple of reps where all of the growth is actually made. And so that's what it's like to be a coach. That's your role. And as the coachee or the person that's new, you want to make sure that you're giving your coach the kind of respect and space so that they can do that and provide that accountability for you. And as the new associate, your role is really just to be willing, coachable, and hungry. Okay. And we'll talk more about what that looks like on the court actually lived. But I want to bring your attention to the bottom here where it says how you do anything is how you do everything, or how you do one thing is how you do everything. And what we mean by that is that if you look in your life, okay, if you tend to cut corners here and there, you're probably someone that cuts corners everywhere. If there's a little bit of lack of integrity where you're promising to do things, but you don't really show up, or if you come late for things, okay, generally speaking, we're creatures of habits. We're not this way in one area and another way in another area. We tend to be creatures of habits, which means we tend to be the same way across in all the different areas of our life. So my request and my invitation to you is that you begin this journey the right way. Okay, because how you start is going to be how you finish. And so if you instill these values in the very beginning, it's going to turn into a much smoother ride along the way. And you're also going to be able to get exponential results. Okay, so now let's go a little bit deeper. So when we talk about willing, what we're pointing at is a preparation for action, right? You have to be prepared to take action without someone pushing you. Now, people are going to guide you. They're going to cheer you on. And sometimes they'll give you a little bit of a kick in the pants. But you have to be prepared to take action without someone pushing you, right? No one can force you to be successful. Okay. And by coachable, we are really meaning something like being open to and asking for and receiving guidance. Okay. It's super critical. This is in everything. Okay. And you also have to be interested in your own personal growth and your own personal development. Okay. So being coachable is being open to asking for and receiving guidance. And we're going to go deeper into this as well. And then being hungry means you have a strong desire to succeed and do well within you. Okay, that within you part is really critical, right? Motivation is something that can come from external, right? Where a lot of times you see these motivational videos, motivation. Look, if a jaguar or a bobcat were to walk into this room right now, that's motivating, right? It's going to get me out of my chair and probably on top of this table or finding a way out of the room. That's motivation. It's something that It's an external stimulus that comes into your life and it pushes you to do something. Now, there's nothing wrong with motivation. It's amazing. It's something that helps you get going. Hunger is something that is within. It's a desire within you that propels you and pulls you into action. So a smart thing is to find something that motivates you, which pushes you, and then also something that there's an internal drive or a pull. So you have that push and pull. Hunger is actually what's going to get you through the difficult days, right? It's going to help you sustain the motivation that you have through good days and bad. And I love this quote from Michael Jordan. He says that my biggest skill was that I was coachable. I was a sponge and aggressive to learn. Okay, I love that. And those of you, I'm sure you guys probably know who Michael Jordan is. If you don't, he's definitely the greatest basketball player of all time. And he's probably one of the greatest athletes across all different sports of all time. And, you know, he said biggest skill was that he was coachable. Okay, so keep that in mind. All of the greats, every great athlete, every great entrepreneur, everybody that's been great at anything, they all have coaches and mentors that are surrounding them, right? Tiger Woods' golf coach is not better than him at golf. He can just see things from a different perspective because he's got a different lens to look through that can help him see the mechanics. They can help him see hip thrust. They can help him see different things, right? Coaches are different than athletes, and you need to have a really great coach to be exceptional. Okay, so let's go a little bit deeper. So willingness is really the quality or state of being prepared to do something. It's really a readiness. So the difference that I see between, for example, being coachable and being willing is that being coachable is kind of receptive. It's kind of being open, and willingness has a component of action to it. There's you're disposed to take action. There's a readiness. Okay. So it says you're inclined or favorably disposed in mind. So disposed means it's kind of like a stance or a posture, like you're a fighter, right? You're ready in that moment. It also means ready and willing and eager to help, right? So there is a component of willingness that is a team-oriented component as well. So you're someone who is prepared to be of service. You're prepared to lend a helping hand. Okay, it also means that you're willing to choose things and accept things and take them on without reluctance, right? It means being willing to sacrifice something in order to gain something greater. Okay, it's one of the most important characteristics that I see for high performers. They're willing to sacrifice certain things by choice. Okay, they're not a martyr, or they're not a victim to, oh, you know, I got to do all these things, and you know, I have to give up this in order to get that. No, someone who has this characteristic, they understand. No, I'm choosing to not do this in order to have this. Right? There's an element of clear choice and consent. Okay. Without the willingness to follow through the necessary steps to achieve success, you're very unlikely to succeed. And that's because success requires work, right? You have to do the work. There is no shortcut or magic formula. Okay. This is one of the biggest, I love Gen X and Gen Z's. And I really think that there's a freshness to the mindset of the young people that are coming today. But the one knock I think that is valid against a lot of the newer generation is that there does seem to be this desire for immediacy, you know, because things come so quickly now because of technology, our brains are kind of hardwired to think that things just come quickly. And the reality is success in business particularly, and if you can look at fitness and things like that as well, it doesn't come quickly. It takes time. It takes effort. You have to move through challenges. There's pain. There's sacrifice. There's a little bit of suffering involved, right? So there's no shortcut to anything in life that's sustainable. You can do money games, for example. It's a type of business that sometimes people confuse with network marketing. There's a type of business called money games. It's not business. OK, Okay. It's all based on short-term gratification, build something really quickly. And then generally what happens is the company fails. And then the same group of people go and they do the same thing somewhere else, right? This is there's no sustainability in that type of business model. It's not wealth creation. It's simply making money. And then training really points at that you have to be willing to attend trainings and you have to know what to do and how to do it, okay? Just like anything else, you have to undertake the training and development that it takes to be successful at anything. And we have an unbelievable system in the STI, Success Team International, of a training development. We go through all of the mindset and all the skill sets and everything that it takes to be successful in life and also in the USANA business. Okay. And maybe more important than anything else is personal development, right? We're going to talk a little bit about Jim Rohn later, but Jim Rohn says you got to be willing to work harder on yourself than you do on your job or anything else. Okay. You're never going to have more or do more until you become more. That's just the way that it is. Your business will always grow in proportion to how you grow as a person. Okay, growth means expanding outside of your comfort zone and taking on new challenges to go beyond boundaries and limitations. Okay, sharing, right? Building a team is impossible without telling others about what we're doing. So being fully self-expressed, being someone that's willing to be vulnerable and share yourself is absolutely critical for building a team and growing something that you can scale. And then you have communicating, okay? So communicating has to do with speaking and listening and understanding another and being open to other points of view or getting feedback, right? So feedback is vital to not only building relationships and trust, but personal growth, right? If you're not capable of receiving constructive criticism or feedback, then you'll never grow. You will always be stunted in your growth by not being able to take feedback from other people. Okay. And then learning requires knowledge and experience as the access to getting better results. Okay. There's no substitute for experience, right? There are certain things that you can't learn in a book, that you can't learn at a personal development seminar, that you can't learn from your mentor. There are certain things that you have to experience personally in order to really okay, I got that. Right? In order to really understand deeply. So being one who shows up and takes action, regardless of your circumstances and instructions from others, is someone who is demonstrating willingness. That's what it looks like. Okay. So now what I want you to do is get out a piece of paper. Okay. We're going to have you measure yourself in each one of these areas. Okay, so just 10 seconds, measure yourself on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being very low, 10 being high. How much do you have the characteristic of willingness? And if you're willing to put it in the chat box, I'd love to see where you rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10 in terms of willingness. And there's going to be a test at the end, okay? I want you guys to send this to whoever you're working with, okay? It's just going to be a few things. But please send your numbers to your coach or your mentor or whoever you're working with, okay? And just remember, it's not bad to be like a 4 and it's not good to be a 9. What matters is that you tell the truth about this to yourself and also to other people, because that's also how you grow, right? You have to be able to look into the mirror and not make it worse than it is and not make it better than it is. That's one of the keys to growth, is being open and honest about simply where you're at. So let's go over a little bit of how to increase willingness, okay? So some ways that you can increase your willingness are try taking action by yourself, right? Try doing things yourself. Even if maybe you have people watching you, okay, you can do it yourself and have other people watching you. So getting away from the habit of having other people do things for you, start taking action for yourself. And then you can also try new things. This is a great way of developing willingness, is to try new things and experience the uncomfortableness of what it's like, for example, to be in a room of people that you've never met before, right? Oftentimes, when you first come into the room, it's uncomfortable, right? When you first start doing something, if you're playing an instrument, if you go to the, you know, you're going to the gym for the first time, okay, you're excited to be there and you're also terrified by all the look of the different equipment and, you know, you don't know how to use it and all the things like that, right? That's when you try something new, you get outside of what they call your comfort zone, right? That's the, you get into the growth zone, which is outside of your comfort zone. And also being open to learning, okay? So taking personal development seminars. If you're working with a coach, ask them, say, coach, send me things that you think will make a difference for my personal development and learning new things, because we have a whole library of things that you can read and watch to help you grow personally. Okay, and then the other big thing is seeing opportunities as part of personal growth and also seeing challenges. Guys, if you can you please mute yourselves if you're coming into the meeting? Awesome. Okay. So seeing challenges as also opportunities for growth as well. Okay. So that's a big part of it. So seeing opportunities as part of personal growth and also seeing challenges and obstacles as simply opportunities to grow as well. All right. Now let's go into coachability. Okay. What does it look like to be coachable? Okay. So being coachable means being capable of being easily taught and trained to do something better. Okay. Being open to and asking for and receiving feedback. So this is really a critical component. Okay. A lot of people don't realize how resistant they are to feedback. They take things personally. Okay. And we'll talk a little bit about that as we go, but you have, in order to be great at anything, you have to kind of shave off the prickly edges when people give you feedback and you get that, oh, that initial kind of like, oh, it doesn't feel good sometimes to get criticism or feedback. You have to really develop a wanting and a desire for feedback, even if it's not what you quote unquote want to hear. When you develop this characteristics of being coachable, you know that it's never personal, right? If you want to grow, you got to know what you're doing well and what you're not doing well. And you'll have an amazing relationship to, the things that you do great, you like that. The things that you're not doing great, you also like that. Like you have the same feeling towards things that you're doing well and not doing well. And sometimes if you're like me, you actually get to the point where what you want to know is where am I coming up short? Where am I not doing well? Not because you're a masochist and you don't feel you like to not feel good about yourself, but because you know this is where the growth is over here in the areas where I'm not excelling. This is what I want to know. I want to know what's not going well so that I can get better. And then also having the ability to look inward at how you can move forward. Okay, so not looking behind you in the past and looking externally for things that can help you grow, okay? Unfortunately, as human beings, we often want to have people give us things. We want things to be delivered to us. We want things to be easier, okay? But when you develop the capacity to be able to look inward, not externally, for the elements that can help you move forward, this is how you become an expert. Okay, you have to be interested in growth. We mentioned not taking things personally. Okay, it's super important in the process. And then seeing feedback as an opportunity. Okay, so being coachable is the state of being guidable, instructable, teachable, and trainable. Okay, it's like a kid. If you ever work with kids, they're curious. They have a strong sense of wonder, and there's a certain openness that they have that things don't have to be a particular way, right? You could drop a kid in the room, and all of a sudden he sees the whole room as an opportunity to play, right? He can turn a pen into a sword. You know what I mean? They're just very open and willing to view things from a different perspective. So having a coach is a highly valuable asset to achieving great things in any field or endeavor in life. Being successful people from all walks of life use coaches to improve their performance and stretch their ability to achieve results. If you look at Olympic athletes, sportsmen, businessmen, actors, everyday and everyday people, having coaches from personal trainers for fitness, voice coaches for singing and acting, life coaches for achieving personal goals and dreams. Okay. You see it in all genres of life. The people that have coaches, they go farther. They excel. And the people that don't, because a lot of times it's hubris or arrogance or pride, let's say it like that, that actually holds people back. They don't want to get a coach because they don't want to admit that there's something wrong. Okay. This is a fixed mindset. It's not a growth mindset. This is how you stop growing and you don't get the results that you want in life, is to defend how good you are now, right? You never want to defend how good you are now. You want to open up to becoming better. And a coach can really show you the way to achieve something, right? Most of the time they've achieved it already, right? And they're guiding you. And they can point out things that we do that are not working and show us how to adjust our performance to get the right result. Okay. Feedback, you can remember this slogan, right? Feedback is the breakfast of champions. Okay. You want to eat feedback for breakfast, man. Without knowing what we do that's not working for us and how to adjust it, we'll continue to produce the same results, right? Einstein said, insanity means doing the same thing and expecting a different result. Doesn't happen. And a coach can also see the end result and has the experience to know how to best to reach it, okay? So one of the best analogies that I've heard of this is, let's say you have a team of people that go to the mountain, right? A Sherpa is someone who's been to the top of the mountain when it comes to mountain climbing, right? Maybe you've heard of this idea of a Sherpa. So a Sherpa is someone who has stood on the top of the mountain and looked down and discovered all of the different ways up the mountain. They have the experience burnt into their brain. They know all of the different ways so that if a boulder falls and blocks your path, they know the other path up the mountain because they've been at the top and they've looked down. When you're at the bottom of the mountain trying to figure out how to get up to the top, it's a very different experience. It's very hard to see all the different pathways. And if you've ever done rappelling or rock climbing, right, your coach is like the person that's at the top of the mountain saying, hey, no, put your foot there, move over here, move, you know, do that, right? They can see the big picture and they can help guide you along the way. Okay, so being coachable is really trusting the coach, regardless of whether you agree or you even understand what they're asking you to do. Okay, in this business and with coaches in general, they're never going to ask you to do something that's not in your best interest. Okay, they're never going to ask you to do something that they haven't already done. Okay, so consider that you don't know how to do what it takes, and that's why you have a coach, right? So only being willing to do things that you agree with or understand is a guaranteed failure. Okay, now you want to ask questions and seek clarity if you're not exactly clear about what they're asking you to do. Okay, but you're not questioning the coach's expertise or questioning carrying out the instructions that are given. Okay, I promise you, if you come into this business and you just do exactly what your coach asks you to do, you will grow and you will grow quickly. All right, so let's go ahead and measure coachability. So on a scale of 1 to 10, how coachable would you say that you are currently? I'll just give you a couple minutes to do that. Please put it in the chat box. And remember, you're going to be turning this into your coach at the end. And there's no bad or good. Okay. If you're a level three and you own the fact that you're a level three in coachability, that means you're already becoming more coachable. So have the courage to be open and honest about where you are on this scale. Okay. So the next question is like, how do you increase coachability, right? Very important question. So the main ways that you can increase coachability are listen to your coach, Okay, very simple. Trust their experience. Be curious. So you want to give up what you already know. This is the most important thing. We talk about it in terms of emptying your cup. So a lot of times in life, we come to everything that we do in life with what we already know. It's just part of being human. You have experiences, you have knowledge. You know what you know, right? And a lot of times you have an idea of the things that you don't know, the things that you're seeking. Okay? Your coach knows what you don't know, right? Because you can never know what you don't know that you don't know, right? It's like a blind spot. What you don't know that you don't know is there in the blinds in the background. You can't see it, right? But your coach can see it very clearly. So we bring to life what we know, and then we have an idea of the things that we don't know, right? That's why you read books. It's like you're seeking knowledge. But the real growth and development, the transformation and results in life comes from the things that you don't know that you don't know. And coaches can see these things. That's why you want people that can see you, right? If you're standing, right, you can't see what's behind you, right? Coaches can do that. You want to surround yourself with people that can see those things. So develop the capacity to be open and ask for receiving guidance. I have to be honest with you guys. When I first started in business, I am a Leo, right? So one of the Achilles heels of Leos is pride. And so when I first started, I was great at being independent and doing things on my own. And I was doing presentations by myself in less than a month. And I was doing all of these things. But one of my biggest hurdles to grow my own personal growth and development was I wanted to look good. So I was more committed to looking good than I was to actually getting better. And I had pride. And so I was very slow to ask for help. I wanted to do things on my own. And there's nothing wrong with wanting to do things on your own. It's amazing to have that kind of desire for personal growth. But you gotta be willing to open to asking for guidance from other people. It will just speed up your growth and development. Okay, so the last element is hunger. Okay, another way to think about this is like desire. Okay, so what does it mean to be hungry? Hungry means being eager, keen, avid, enthusiastic, right? That internal desire that we were talking about. Wanting something and being prepared to do whatever it takes to get it, right? As long as it doesn't lack integrity or, you know, break the law. Right? Really, like being willing to do whatever it takes to be successful and get what you want. That kind of willingness to chew through steel to get what you want, right? That internal desire and hunger. It's also a motivation to achieve or acquire something without external, that should say inspiration to achieve or acquire something without external motivation, right? You're intrinsically motivated. We call that inspiration to go after something. And you have a strong wish, desire, or craving or need for something, right? Tony Robbins said, when you turn your wants, the things that you want in your life, okay, that actually might be a desire, right? The things that you want, and you turn them into a need or a want or a must. That's how you can propel yourself to creating extraordinary new results. You take the things that you want and then you turn them into a must or a need. Okay. You need water. You need air. You need food in order to live, right? If you can turn success into something that you need to fuel your system, now you have a formula for being unstoppable. And the key to hunger is this is, you know, there's no way around this. Okay. No one can be hungry for you. No one can want what you want for you, right? You have to be hungry to change something in your life. You have to be hungry to achieve a goal or a dream. Nobody can do that for you. Okay. After a decade of coaching people, one of the most painful things as a coach is that you cannot move someone that doesn't want to be moved. You can't want for them more than they want for themselves. And as coaches, oftentimes we run into this. I have a strong desire and I want someone to be so successful, but their level of desire is not on the same level, right? And so I used to try to push people. And now I don't do that because I finally understood you can only lead a horse to water, right? You can run with people, you can jog with people, right? But you can't pull people along. If you have to drag someone, you just have to leave them where they are. Okay. So pulling the results towards you by taking the actions the necessary actions to achieve your results is an internal game, right? It's an internal game. Everything that is amazing in life is an internal game, right? Being a good person, it's an internal game. Okay. Even if you're doing all the right things, but you're doing it just to fit in or look good, this is not character. Right? Character is integrity, is doing something because it's the right thing to do. Right? We can be inspired by other people's achievements, but unless we're hungry for our own achievements, we will not be motivated to go out there and make them happen. We will not be motivated to go out and do what it takes. Okay, this is a kind of a different training, but the difference between a fixed mindset and a growth mindset is when they see someone succeed, they feel inspiration. They feel compelled to do that. They want that. They're moving towards that. They get inspired by other people's success. A fixed mindset person becomes disempowered when they see other people achieving amazing results, because they think that there's something special that person has, and they think there's something missing or something wrong with them, right? So when they see other people succeed, they feel smaller because they feel like they can never achieve that. Having hunger and having this kind of growth mindset, you know, anything that anyone else learns, I can also learn, right? This mindset will beat talent every day of the week. If you take a young kid who's supremely talented, but they're arrogant and they know they're talented and they kind of cut corners, and you take a kid who maybe has a lot less talent, but has a strong desire and a willingness to grow, and they believe that they can learn anything. As time goes on, the talented kid will stunt, his growth will slow down. And the kid that maybe who starts down here, his hunger will beat that talented kid every single time. Remember that. You are the only limit on what's possible for you. Someone who's hungry will seek out knowledge and assistance from people that can help them. This is so important. Even there's a young kid in our business named Jericho Orlina. He's 21 years old. He went diamond in 18 months. Guys, diamond means he just went one-star diamond, which means you're making $5,000 a week. And he did that in 18 months. And one of the things that I've noticed about Jericho very, very clearly is he always reaches out to other people to get mentorship, even though he's oftentimes doing better, quote unquote, better than them, right? He's extremely hungry to grow and learn, right? The other day he reached out to our mentor, Jeremy Stansfield, 9-star diamond director, the founder of our STI family, right? He's been with USANA for over 20 years. Jeremy was sharing on the mastermind the other day, the way that he knew that Jericho was going to be great was after one of the times that Jeremy did a public speaking event in the Philippines, the first person that contacted him, Jericho. Okay, that's someone who's hungry to grow. I want to know what you know. And not just I want to know what you know, but I'm willing to ask you because I want it that bad. So that's really going the extra mile to become better at the skills and interested in finding out the necessary information and formulas and putting those things into practice, the things that you're learning. Okay, it's not enough to learn. You must execute. Right? There are also people that absorb all the tools and the training available like a sponge, and they ask questions that can help them further their progress. I remember when one of the diamonds came from the Philippines to Indonesia when I was in Indonesia growing there. And she said, drop everything for training. That's their motto in the Philippines. That's why they grow so radically fast. Drop everything for training. They prioritize their personal growth and development. They prioritize their skill training and their mindset training. right? They make that first. Sharpen the saw. When you sharpen the saw, you can cut down any tree. All right, so let's go ahead and measure your hunger. Okay, I'm interested to see this one because a lot of times people have the willingness and the coachability, but they haven't yet developed the hunger. So on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being low, 10 being, you know, ready to chew through steel and willing to do whatever it takes, where would you say honestly that you are on a scale of on a scale of 1 to 10 when it comes to hunger? And coaches, the guys that are on here, I want you to make sure that you follow up. Make sure you're recording the results from your people. And if they're not putting it in there, please follow up, okay? This is super important for everybody to, for self-awareness and also for your coach to be able to work with you, that you're open and honest about where you're at in these three areas. Okay, so the last question is, how do you increase hunger? Here are some ways, right? You can connect with why you want to do this, okay? We've all heard about the why, right? You got to have a deep why. You got to have a strong why. You got to have an internal drive, right? Napoleon Hill, who wrote one of the greatest books of all time, next to maybe the Bible, Think and Grow Rich. In that book, he called it a burning desire. Like literally being on fire with a desire for what you want in your life. Like literally walking around like your hair is on fire, right? Your hair is on fire and you're looking for water to put it out, right? That's the kind of hunger that you want. Okay, and other ways are that you can really focus on the outcomes and the benefits of the things that you want. Like really drill into your mind, get clear about that. Have a vision board, have a mission statement, have a vision statement for yourself where you remember what it is that you want, right? That's part of the getting clear about your personal motivation, is actually write it down, get clear about it. Okay, you guys have probably seen it 1,000 times, but in my bathroom, right on the bottom left-hand corner of my bathroom mirror is my mission statement, my vision statement. And I start that every day, dear God, thank you. And then I go through all the things that are my goals for the year. And I am willing to transform anything that gets in the way of my own personal success or the success of my STI family. Okay, you got to have that WIT, whatever it takes, attitude. All right, so that really brings us to the end. And I would love to hear some sharing from people, like what are you hearing for yourself newly? Or what did you learn about yourself today? Who would like to go first? This is, by the way, this is part of being coachable.
I learned that Dr. Benny is ready to rock.
It's true.
His numbers was 9, 9, and 10. And his like experience of USANA is linked to his focus and action and his growth. So I've seen big growth from the outside in your game, Benny. And that's no surprise when you then give your results, right? So some people give high results, but it doesn't actually align with who they're being. Whereas your beingness is very strong. So that makes perfect sense. And I think you have a very strong future. Same for my other friends on the call. But as we're kind of different teams, but same teams, Benny, I can be honest without worrying about feedback.
Yeah, well, I'm same as you, Nathan. I'm Leo too. And I have enormous pride. If you can see, this is my pride will block the camera.
I'm a Leo too, by the way.
Good. We make strong leaders.
I realized that based on your scale, your test, I have this pride is like has a big ego too, that sometimes holding me down to be willing to be coachable, but I'm hungry, but I'm like trapped by myself.
Yeah, this is what I realized. Even yesterday, I was attending one webinar thing on something else. And I realized that I know that the only thing holding me back is probably myself.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
Yeah.
It's like I self-sabotage myself from time to time. That's what I realized.
Okay, great. So in what way do you self-sabotage yourself?
Like if I'm doing really good this week, then I really slack off the week after.
Got it.
Yeah.
Got it. Great. See, that's really great to know for yourself personally and also for people that work with you, right? Because they can help you. They can help you with accountability. So what you just did, Priyanka, is very important because it's one thing to recognize I'm the only limit on myself. Okay. You can go find that out on Instagram every day, right? That's not helpful. You knowing what that means for you is everything. So it is true that you're the only limitation to what you want in your life, right? I think we all know that actually intuitively, but it looks different ways for all of us, right? So for some people, exactly what you said, they feel like they deserve a break, or they feel like when they get what they want, they should take a little bit of time off.
And also, like, suppose maybe Simmer asked me on Monday, like, okay, how many people are you going to contact and stuff? Like, I tend to give a higher number that I'm comfortable with than mm-hmm. I'm comfortable with because, you know, pride. So I'm like, okay, I'm like, so basically she's not pushing me hard. I'm pushing myself harder. And then I feel pressurized by it myself. So, yeah, it's
okay.
So then I feel like not doing things because I'm too pressurized or something. It's weird, but yeah.
Well, it's not weird at all. So you say bigger numbers because you feel like you should be saying bigger numbers, not because you want to do those numbers.
Yeah, yeah.
That's great. It's great to get. And thank you for being open and honest, right? I really acknowledge you for being honest about that. So there's two things that you can do about that, Priyanka, because one of them is being comfortable having big goals and not being afraid to fail. So one of the things that I've learned is that you do have to find out what your operating mechanism is, because you don't want to set big goals and then just not care whether you meet them or not. Right.
Mm.
But you also don't want to set big goals and then kill yourself if you don't achieve them. Right.
Yeah.
So you got to find this like dynamic tension where you set a big goal that's really motivating for you and you're willing to do whatever it takes to get there, but also understand that, as Les Brown said, right? If you shoot for the moon, even if you miss, you're still amongst the stars.
Mm.
Right. So that's one of the good things about having a huge, big goal is even if you only get 3/4 of the way there, you're actually much farther than if you set a small goal and you reach it.
Yeah.
So, but that's amazing. Thank you for your honesty, Priyanka. Who else would like to share what you got for yourself out of the training today?
We have some new people on the call, so maybe someone new wants to share.
I will just call on you. So, David, what did you get out of the training today for yourself?
Well, from my opinion, I realized that being coachable is like no matter how capable you are, you should just listen from others' people's advice, because based on my experience, the theory that we are using nowadays, after 10 years or maybe 20 years, it won't be that optimal because the words keep improving, right? And from my experience and knowing people, like I'm willing to share knowledge with others, but some with a great ego, like basically I'll just share from what I experienced in the gym.
Okay.
I met a big guy, he do something like a deadlift with a wrong form that I encourage him that should not be doing this or else he'll get injured. But from his heart, you say, my body's bigger, why would I took advice from someone smaller than me, right? And that's it, he just challenged me. And when I was willing to share knowledge with him to improve together and learn together, but he just reject me like that.
Yeah. And you know, and you never know. I'll tell you, David, first of all, I acknowledge you for being willing to put yourself out there and give that coaching for him, you know. And sometimes people that have big egos, I'm the same way, right? I might be like, oh yeah, I know that already, right? But then as soon as the person leaves the room, I'm like, okay. And I take what they learn, I take what they share, and I'm like, I'll apply it. I may not tell them that I applied it, right? Because of ego. So you never know as a coach, you may actually make a big difference for someone, whether you know it or not.
Yeah, I totally agree with that.
Yeah.
And what I hear is just because he's bigger than you, like lots of the time, especially with myself, like sometimes I'm arrogant, but actually the flip side of arrogant is a lack of confidence,
mm-hmm.
right? So if he's got this young guy, cool hair, new at the gym, giving him feedback, like he could easily be like nervous or unsure how to act around you, right?
Yeah, actually he feels so competitive. Because basically I'm a power lifter, so that's it's normal for my strength is bigger than him. He's a bodybuilder. And you see, my body's bigger than you. How could it be weaker than you?
Mm-hmm.
And every time he always do stuff like I do and he want to compete with my weight, that's it. And not injure himself. Till now he's talking behind me. Yeah, I just ignored it.
Good. Keep focusing on yourself.
Yeah, that's what I realized. We should become a person who have coachability.
Perfect. Yes. Awesome.
And thank also, you. David, like you said to me before, since you took USANA, you're lifting heavier now. So if he is confused, you can say it's okay. One is you need to get good hair like David. But also number two, it's good to try the USANA as well.
Mm-hmm.
Both will help him in life.
I don't think so. He'll listen to me.
You never know.
I really asked him a lot of time. He just can't work with his ego.
There you go. We learn not to be the same then.
Yeah, that's why I don't waste my time on this kind of person. Actually, I just do my things, then he do his stuff.
Awesome. Thank you for sharing, David. How about you, El?
I love this topic, coachable willingness and hunger.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, honestly, I'm very sorry. I feel that maybe before I won't join this session because I'm too tired today.
Mm-hmm.
But then I said to Dan, like, I just have my dinner, and he said, like, eat and listen. And I just feel like, eat and listen? Okay. So my cousin come from Malang, so I'm in the middle of juggling, like greeting them, and then I just moved from Sukawati to Denpasar, like takes 30 minutes to come here, and then before we have like one Zoom call. So I just like heard you a few times, but then like it's kind of a reminder for me, like you can if you think you can. So I always say to like younger people than me, I say to them, like, if you have vision to be president, then if you sleep, you will be minister, right? But if you don't want to be like something or somebody, then if life or like situation or condition puts you as tukang becak, you know becak? What is becak in English? Cap?
Tricycle. Tricycle. Is it tricycle?
Tuk-tuk driver?
Cab driver, right.
Okay, sure.
So if life puts you as the cab driver, then you cannot like blame the life itself because you don't have like any purpose. So like have your purpose higher, as high as you can.
Mm.
And thank you for sharing, Nathan. It's all cool.
Awesome. It's all cool, man. And thank you for sharing. Henry Ford said, if you think you can or you think you can't, you're always right. So thank you for that.
Uni shared in the chat, Mr. Nathan.
Yeah, I saw that. So I said, I am willing to get members, come invite people, join, and feel, I think you mean feel hungry in USANA.
Yeah.
She's in Bandung, right?
Yeah.
Also a personal trainer.
Yoga.
Oh, yoga.
Very cool.
Awesome. So who else would like to share? Apple? Anyone else?
Now, so bye guys.
Bye Priyanka, thanks for sharing.
Yeah, I think for me, out of the three, like from being in USANA for a few years, is like keeping the hunger going. Like I feel that I'm high score on most things, like willing and coachable, and then like the hunger is like getting reconnected to my why. So like tonight I'm gonna be reworking my stories to share, like my business and product stories, so that I can get reconnected to it or create something newly that would keep me inspired to keep going.
Got it. Yeah, I will tell you that the one that generally trips people up the most is hunger. And I've been doing this test with people a lot, and the one that people consistently score the lowest on is hunger.
It's also the one that is us putting ourselves at risk as well, right? Potentially.
Definitely. You're always, if you're out there doing things that are big things and that will impact the world significantly, you will spend your entire life basically being at risk. Rennie said, sometimes when you're in your comfort zone, it's hard to get the hunger. I would argue that it's impossible to be hungry when you're in your comfort zone. If you're only ever in your zone of what your competence, what they call your zone of competence, so the world of what you already know, then you will naturally be in a state of a lack of hunger, which isn't necessarily bad. I'm not saying that that's a bad thing, but it's not going to help you grow and develop yourself outside of that. So that is for sure, Rennie. Is there anything else you want to share about that, Rennie?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I feel like I'm in my comfort zone right now. Like, you know, I'm too comfortable with the thing that I want and the thing that I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really hard to get the trigger of hunger. Like, you know, setting a big goals and... Because I feel like I'm getting it day by day, but in terms of like the bigger picture, I don't know where I'm going. So
yeah.
Because I'm just too comfortable with the way I am right now. So I wanna ask you what you suggest for me to get the hunger. Like, what is, should I like get the like hot button of myself to get the hunger? I don't know.
Yeah, I'll be honest with you, Rennie. I believe very strongly that underneath of a lack of clarity about what you want in your life is always fear. Some sort of fear that you're not going to achieve it, or some sort of fear that that the world won't approve of what it is that you want, or something. There's something like that is generally underneath of it. So we'll set small goals in life, or we'll settle into our comfort zone because either we don't believe that something outside of that is possible for us, or we believe that there's something wrong with the thing that we really desire. Something like that. Like being successful, for example, will take you outside of the tribe of people that you're accepted in at the moment. Sometimes that will often be the case. So it's really just getting super clear about your why, like authentically. Because when you really find what it is that is deeply motivating for you, okay, not the thing that you think should be motivating for you, okay, this is where people get tripped up so much. They choose goals and dreams and desires based on what they think they should be motivated by. But when you find the thing that you're really passionate about deeply, you know, you won't have to, you'll know, it will light you up, and it will be something that burns inside. But a lot of times you have to get rid of the layers of things that are in the way of you allowing yourself to experience that. You got to go, Dan? Oh, he said bye. Him and Elle have a prospecting appointment. So, Rinny, I think did you book an appointment for us to talk?
I will soon. Probably this weekend.
Okay, so get with me, and I have a couple of things that I think could make a big difference for you. Some things that we used with Carmen, our coach. Some things that can really help, you know, work through.
Yeah.
That for you.
Okay.
But yeah, for sure. Once you get the hot button, you might have to keep pushing it in life. You know, you can find out what you're really destined for and what you really are highly desire, and that flame can go out, and then you can reignite it again, and then it can go out, and then you can reignite it again. So it's not like you find the one thing that you're destined for and you're just going to be on fire forever. Okay, this is a fairy tale. But there is something within you that when you do tap into it, it will make you, it will move you deeply.
All right.
but it's great that you're looking for it and you're acknowledging that you're in your comfort zone. Oh, it's just like meditation and yoga, right? First step is always awareness. It's always an awareness of the way that it is. All right, so I think that will bring us to our end. I've actually got another meeting now myself. Okay, so thank you guys so much for coming this week. I love you all. Let's do a quick photo. Are people able to come on camera? Hi, Jeanette. Uni. Mustika. Okay. Satu. Oh, I need to put on. Oh, there we go. Boom. I said I'm a Leo, right? So I think that's a lion. Is that a lion or a tiger? I'll just say it's a lion. Okay. Satu Dua Tiga. Okay, awesome. I will put the picture in the SDI group. Have a wonderful night, guys. I love you guys. And we'll see you next Thursday, yeah?
Thanks, Nathan. Thanks, everyone.
Bye, everyone. Bye.